who labor in this part of vineyard, whom not ashamed to call brethren, could this greeting to them that perspective places. Always to know that are watching by way of live internet, to the dispersed, to the scattered, to the Jews first, and also to the Gentiles. Could this greeting to them in their respective places. As we often say, last, never least, to the Way of Yah Synagogue. Proper honor to you all in your respective places. Once again, from TV, internet, radio, wherever our voice can be heard, wherever we can be seen. Before we came on, had nothing come on. When we go out, absolutely. Nothing. Ain't nothing else coming on. If they're not teaching Kodesh, living a clean, sanctified life, the people ain't in nothing, and they hadn't heard nothing.
Whoa,
this is an attempt
to collect the debt.
Whatever you hypocrite, false pretend, backbite, mumble, and grumble against will be used in that collection of a debt. The messages are always being recorded for quality assurance and make sure no side deals get cut with nobody, but everybody got to come in, Brother Red.
Out the door.
Straight, narrow path. All right. Let's see if we jump over, if we would, and pick up the 22nd chapter of the book of Acts of the Apostles. Let's see what they got to do with anything. Matter of fact, make it right before you get there, give me Acts of the Apostles chapter 9. 9 and about verse 15. And before you get that, how about give me 1 Peter chapter 5 and about verse 19? For whatever reason, let's see what that say. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 10.
Amen.
Listen to the book.
But the God of all grace, who hath called us unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that ye have suffered a while.
Do what now?
Make you perfect, establish, strengthen, settle you.
That makes a difference. After that ye have suffered a while. What does he do?
Make you perfect.
Make you perfect. Always say mature, complete. After that ye have suffered a while. Make you perfect. What else?
Establish.
Establish.
Strengthen.
Strengthen.
Settle you.
That's what we look at. A lot of times, why some of you guys don't have the spirit, because you hadn't suffered. Truth of the matter is, you hadn't actually suffered. And you got to suffer something. Even the Bible teaches, yea, and all that will live godly, as 2 Timothy chapter 3. 2 Timothy chapter 3. That's right. Remember about verse 9. Some kind of way we're going to come back and try to tie all this in the Acts of the Apostles chapter 9 and Acts chapter 22. Like I told you guys before, our main goal, our agenda is to make sure we all get the righteous faith. Isn't that right? Which we'll break down to the root word, the right faith. And there are a lot of people have faith, but it's not the right faith. Okay? So we want the righteous faith. In order to achieve that, then we realize there are some things we have to go through. And some things we're going to have to deny ourselves of. The things we're going to be willing to separate ourselves from, like we talked about our father Abraham on yesterday. All right, listen to the book.
But they shall proceed no further,
mm-hmm.
for their folly shall be made manifest unto all men.
Come on.
As theirs also was.
Yeah.
But thou hast fully known my doctrine.
My what?
Manner of life.
Yeah.
Purpose.
Yeah.
Faith, long-suffering, charity, patience, persecutions, afflictions, which came unto me at Antioch.
Y'all hear what he said? So that I've fully known it. All these different things he went down, my faith, charity, persecution, all this stuff that came to me in Antioch. Listen.
At Antioch, at Iconium, at Lystra, what persecutions I endured.
Listen.
But out of them all, the Lord delivered me.
That's our confidence. Out of them all, the Lord delivered me. Just like with the son. The Lord delivered him from being spit on, being hit, being buffeted, being nailed to the cross, and even in his death, he came back to redeem him. He said, out of them all, the Lord redeemed me from him. He delivered me. Come on.
Yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution.
Some?
And all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution.
But what is going to happen?
But evil men and seducers
shall do what?
Wax worse and worse.
Doing what?
Deceiving.
And?
Being deceived.
Now y'all got a chance to look at where you stand today. Now, either you're suffering or you're getting worse and worse. You're getting worse and worse, then you know where you're at. Because everybody that's going to live godly going to suffer persecution. Not some. That's why we fake so fast. Because the easy thing, it's easy to put our eyes on other people and start saying, well, nothing's happening with them, then they live in godly. Something happened to somebody, that person immediately becomes a curse. God is cursing them. When he just said, yea, all that will live godly in Christ Jesus are going to suffer persecution. When Judah was put out of their land, everybody was guilty. Who had to suffer? Everybody. When the Lord called the sword to come in, he said, we're going to come on to who? He said, we're going to come on the righteous and the wicked. So every time you suffer, don't have to be because you're wrong. You could be suffering for the fact that you're righteous. But evil men and seducers are going to wax worse and worse. The way you can examine yourself, what's your behavior? Do you show a manifestation of change in your life, or do you continue to do the same stupid stuff? Which means you're getting worse and worse. And the sad part is you're saying you're better when you know you're not changing. So now you're deceived. You're being, and then you start deceiving other people that you're doing what you're supposed to do. Something to consider. Something to consider today. Come on, jump over to that ninth chapter of the book of Acts of the Apostles. Acts chapter 9. Ah, come on, give me verse 1. Let me see what that says. I don't want to, but let's talk a little bit. Acts 9 and 1. Listen to the book.
And Saul, yet breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord, went unto the high priest and desired of him letters to Damascus to the synagogues, that if he found any of this way, whether they were men or women, he might bring them bound unto Jerusalem.
Yeah.
And as he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly there shined round about him a light from heaven.
Come on.
And he fell to the earth and heard a voice saying unto him,
who?
Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me?
It's what?
And he said, who art thou, Lord?
And the Lord said,
I am Jesus, whom thou persecutest.
We already know it's one Lord. Come on.
It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks.
Come on.
And he, trembling and astonished, said, Lord, what wilt thou have me to do?
Yeah.
And the Lord said unto him, arise and go into the city, and it shall be told thee what thou must do.
Come on.
And the men which journeyed with him stood speechless, hearing a voice, but seeing no man.
Yeah.
And Saul arose from the earth, and when his eyes were opened, he saw no man, but they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus.
Yeah.
And he was 3 days without sight, and neither did eat nor drink.
Come on.
And there was a certain disciple at Damascus named Ananias, and to him said the Lord in a vision, Ananias, and he said, behold, I am here, Lord.
Come on.
And the Lord said unto him, arise and go into the street which is called Straight, and inquire in the house of Judas for one called Saul of Tarsus, for behold, he prayeth.
Come on.
And have seen in a vision a man named Ananias coming in and putting his hand on him that he might receive his sight.
Come on.
Then Ananias answered, Lord, I have heard by many of this man how much evil he have done to thy saints at Jerusalem.
Come on.
And here he hath authority from the chief priest to bind all that call on thy name.
Come on.
But the Lord said unto him, go thy way, for he is a chosen vessel unto me.
To do what?
Bear my name before the Gentiles.
Before the Gentiles.
And kings.
Kings.
And the children of Israel.
Yeah.
For I will shew him how great things he must suffer for my name's sake.
Everybody that will live godly got to suffer persecution. Everybody got to suffer something. The mere fact that you guys come here and you look to escape and you thought you got away from something, you actually came to something, which makes a difference. Isn't that right? Paul had to be blinded. Whoever first had sight had to be blinded that he can actually have his eyes illuminated to light. Same thing we got to do. You got to become illuminated. You got to become blind, which means other things that you saw at past, you got to get your eye focused off of. And that's what happened with some of you guys. You still focus on your past. You still focus on the old way and the old things, the things you could have had or the things you had. You feel like those things were still something. Yet Paul said, I count all those things but what? Dung and lost. You got to lose something. How's something gained? He said, for me to live is who? Christ. And to die is what? Gain. We look at it as a gain. Anything we even lose, man, we look at it as a gain. Because we look what we look to apprehend at the exchange of what we're giving up. You guys keep yourself focused on what you let go, what you could have had, how you should have held on. You shouldn't have ever did it. You hate you ever kind of made a decision. Maybe you should have waited. Maybe you shouldn't have never did it. Maybe it's not for you because you're still entangled with the world. That's the only reason you can come up with that, because you're still entangled with the world. Ain't that right? That's a detriment to you over time. It's a detriment to you. See, we got to come to, a lot of times we hadn't actually been told what was required of us when we came in. I actually didn't know. But I thank the Lord for how things happen and how things work to put me in set, or in retrospect of looking at now, you got to lose something. In order for you to take on eternal life, there has to be an exchange of your life. You got to let something go. Pick me up if you would at the book of Isaiah. We'll come back over. Chose this man to be a chosen vessel unto him. This is Isaiah chapter 45. See if it's about verse 17. Isaiah 45 and 17. Listen to the book.
But Yisrael shall be saved in the Lord with an everlasting salvation.
Y'all hear what he said? Israel shall be saved from the Lord. Saved of the Lord.
Shall be saved in the Lord.
Saved in the Lord.
With an everlasting salvation.
Listen.
Ye shall not be ashamed, nor confounded, world without end.
Y'all hear that? Come on.
For thus saith the Lord that created the heavens.
Yeah.
God himself that formed the earth and made it.
Y'all hear God himself. He ain't talking about plural, did he? Multiple. God himself. Come on.
He hath established it.
He has established it.
He created it not in vain.
He didn't create it in vain.
He formed it to be inhabited.
Yeah.
I am the Lord, and there is none else.
Come on.
I have not spoken in secret,
mm-hmm.
in a dark place of the earth.
Yeah.
I said not unto the seed of Jacob, seek ye me in vain.
Uh-huh.
I, the Lord, speak righteousness. I declare things that are right.
Come on.
Assemble yourselves and come. Draw near together, ye that are escaped of the nations.
Yeah.
They have no knowledge that set up the wood of their graven image,
mm-hmm.
and pray unto a God that cannot save.
Yeah.
Tell ye and bring them near. Yea, let them take counsel together.
Mm-hmm.
Who hath declared this from ancient time?
Yeah.
Who hath told it from that time?
Mm-hmm.
Have not I the Lord? And there is no God else beside me.
Yeah.
A just God and a Savior.
Yeah.
There is none beside me.
Mm-hmm.
Look unto me and be ye saved.
Y'all heard what he just told him to do?
Turn.
Turn. Turn. And be ye saved. Hold your gap. See that St. John chapter 9 at verse 30.
Amen.
So ain't none besides me. Turn to me and be ye saved. This is the 9th chapter of the book of St. John at verse 30. Listen to the book.
The man answered and said unto them.
What did he tell them?
Why herein is a marvelous thing.
That?
Ye know not from whence he is, and yet he hath opened mine eyes.
Listen.
Now we know that God heareth not sinners.
But what happened?
If any man be a worshiper of God.
Yeah.
And doeth his will.
What happened?
Him he heareth.
Yeah.
Since the world began, was it not heard that any man opened the eyes of one that was born blind?
Come on.
If this man were not of God, he could do nothing.
So we look at Lord coming and illuminating people, just like he did with Paul. Some things you have to suffer. At 9:1, listen.
And as Jesus passed by, he saw a man which was blind from his birth.
Blind from his birth. What happened, son?
And his disciples asked him.
What did they want to know?
Saying, Master.
Who what?
Did sin.
This?
Man or his parents.
What happened?
That he was born blind.
And what did he tell them?
Neither hath this man sinned.
Nor?
His parents.
But what happened?
That the works of God should be made manifest in him.
So some of the things that come on you and some of the things that happen. Why you don't ever consider it? It's because you're living righteous and you have to suffer. Why y'all look at the things you suffer as reasons to stop or to quit? This man knew that any man turning be a worshiper of God, him of God hear it. Eventually, God came to answer and God came to live. If you're living right, if you're doing what you're supposed to do, it's got to yield a peaceable fruits of Kodesh. But a lot of times you guys don't consider that. It's bad that the formula we come up with, if something happened, if it happened more than a week or a month or a year or 2 years or 3 years, then of course we've got to be cursed of God. There is no answer and there is no remedy. God has forsaken, has turned his back on us. But he wanted Israel to know, to look to me. I'm your savior. There's none other but me. This man being born blind, you got to think about it. Here you are born blind and you watching all these other, well, you're not watching, you're hearing other kids and they have sight. And no doubt you got to question yourself, what happened? The reason I was born a child blind. What happened? Or I didn't have hearing and I could see other kids that can hear. What happened to me? Why am I accursed before God? Even the son, when he sat on the cross, he asked, my God, why hast thou human? That's a human factor, emotion. Born of God, spirit, flesh, born of man. What was he going to say on the cross? These people been hitting me, spitting on me, giving me sour wine, and I'm sitting here hanging up all these hours on him. Why have you forsaken me? Why am I sitting in this condition? Instead of sitting there, and we should have learned from this, and should have considered, when we sit in a situation, it ain't got to be because we committed sin, but it could be that the works of God might be made manifest. That he'll come. This is bad that this man was able to stand up and to say, had it not been said. Let me see what he said again at the 30th verse. Listen.
The man answered and said unto them.
The man answered and said unto them.
Why herein is a marvelous thing.
That what happened?
Ye know not from whence he is.
Yeah.
And yet he hath opened mine eyes.
What happened?
Now we know that God.
Now y'all know that? We know this. That what happened?
Now we know that God heareth not sinners.
But what happened?
If any man be a worshiper of God and doeth his will, him he heareth.
What happened?
Since the world began, was it not heard that any man opened the eyes of one that was born blind?
The man said, this already been taught. I already had that knowledge. Paul even asked when they came down, we talked in 1 Corinthians 8 chapter, how is it that this knowledge is not in every man? His situation had changed the fact of what he knew. You know what happened with the average of us? What killed us was sickness or something come on us, our marriage had failed. We automatically block out what we heard or what we've been taught. This man said, had it not been said since the world began, any man open the eyes of the blind? He said, only way God, we know if God answered what he said, he was a worshiper of God. He's a doer to God will. That's why God could hear this man. That's why this happened. And yet he could testify. A man born blind could testify to it. That's bad that you guys have sight, hearing, and other things you have. Your kids are well and other stuff operating. Your heating. You got food and heat, clothing, automobiles. And you can't even testify to the goodness of God. You can't even testify to what the word said from time even of old. This man was able to go back and recant. Had it not been said of old, that if a man have this ability, that he's a worshiper and a doer of God's will. Why are you stuck on where he from? But there's somebody black for you. We're going to start dinner with something. I just need to know where he from before I can believe it. Something that has absolutely nothing done with what he did. I always worry about stuff that has nothing to do with your salvation. He's looking at the fact, what have we been taught? If you are a worshiper, if you turn to God and do his will, that's when God will hear you. That's the same thing had to happen to Israel. When the son sat on the cross, his consolation was in that the Lord was going to deliver him. That's his consolation. Come on back to the 45th chapter of the book of Isaiah. Turn that heat off. I want him to go to sleep. It's too early for him. There's a slight muggy in here, isn't it? Break the mug. This is Isaiah chapter 45. What verse you at? 22?
Yes, sir.
Isaiah 45, 22. Listen to the book.
Look unto me and be ye saved.
Turn to me and be ye saved. Come
all
on.
All the ends of the earth.
All the ends of the earth.
For I am God.
Uh-huh.
And there is none else.
There is none else.
I have sworn by myself.
Yeah.
The word is going out of my
mouth. We heard before when the Lord could swear by no greater, he swore by himself. Right. Which means if I lie, I got to stop existing. You could put it on heaven, or you could put it on earth. Those things can stop existing, the first and the second. But when he could swear by himself, he look at, I live forever.
Right.
So what I said is got to happen. That's consolation to us. I swear by my socks. My socks can get old. They can tear up. Thread can go. I can lose a sock. It can be lost in the dryer. That's nothing. And I still exist. So when he could swear by nothing, he swore by himself. He said, I swore by myself. Come on.
the word is going out of my mouth
and
in
what
righteousness.
Happened? It going out in righteousness.
And shall not return.
Listen.
That unto me every knee shall bow.
And?
Every tongue shall swear.
Listen. They're going to take an oath. Come on.
Surely shall one say, in the Lord have I righteousness and strength.
Listen.
Even to him shall men come.
Listen.
And all that are incensed against him.
All that are what now?
That are incensed against him.
That are what now?
Incensed against him.
What happens, son?
Shall be ashamed.
They shall be ashamed. Y'all know what that means? All of those that are angry with him. All of those that were angry with him. They're going to be ashamed. Y'all all right?
Amen.
Now, where we find this at? At the 27th chapter of the book of Matthew. Verse 53. This is Matthew chapter 27, verse 53. Listen to the book.
And came out of the graves after his resurrection and went into the Kodesh city and appeared unto many.
Come on.
Now when the centurion and they that were with him watching Jesus saw the earthquake and those things that were done, they feared greatly, saying,
what?
Truly, this was the Son of God.
Y'all see that? Them that were angry. Y'all heard where they were angry at? Huh? Luke chapter 23. Let me see verse 46. Luke chapter 23, verse 46. Listen to the book.
And when Jesus had cried with a loud voice,
what happened, son?
He said, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit.
Come on.
And having said thus, he gave up the ghost.
Listen.
Now when the centurion saw what was done, he glorified God, saying, certainly this was a righteous man.
Certainly this was a righteous man. Listen what happened.
And all the people that came together to that sight.
And all the people that came together to that sight.
Beholding the things which were done.
That was watching what had happened.
Smote their breasts.
They started beating their chests. Why do you think they were beating their chests? Because they were angry. They were angry. The book had already testified that they were going to do this. And these people were going to come back to be ashamed. Those people that were there, they had seen it, they were angry. They started beating on their chest. Now somebody sitting there watching wouldn't have thought a whole lot about that, wouldn't they? Because they wouldn't have known the law. Which allows us to know ain't nothing just happened. The word got there. He said, the word had gone out of my mouth. I sworn in righteousness. I spoke in righteousness. I ain't got no reason to lie. These same people had to come back to be ashamed. We'll let you know the same thing. These people come back and do it. But even Peter talked about that those people that judge and take your good conversation, that later they might come back and do what? Be ashamed, having no what? Having no evil thing to say of you. Where you think he got that from? What were they saying about him before? They said the man had a devil. They said the man was a serpent, remember? Those folk were so angry they were beating their chest. Yet Isaiah testified those same people that were angry wanted to come back and they were going to be ashamed. Come on back to that 45th chapter of the book of Isaiah. Some of y'all, you let everybody throw you, offset you from what it is you believe. You lose your steadfastness. See, and it's real easy. Because you start dealing with family, responsibility, and the biggest enemy you got yourself, it's easy to get off course. It's easy to start to compile all that together and make an excuse why you're not where you need to be and why you can't serve God. Well, you got to look and see, all this stuff got to happen. And when yesterday, Minister Bostic read a scripture at the beginning. Who remember what it was? It was Luke the 17th chapter. You ain't got to look at your paperwork. I remember. I know everything. It said it was impossible. Offense must come. But woe unto them by whom the offense come. What you think wind up happening with these people? Hold what you got right quick. Revelation 1 and 7. Revelation chapter 1 and verse 7. Listen to the book.
Behold, he cometh with clouds.
And every
eye shall see him.
And what happened?
And they also which pierced him.
What happened?
And all kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him.
What happened?
Even so, amen.
So be it. What you think will happen to these people that do what they do to us? That's why he told you it were better for them if a millstone had been about their neck, they were cast into the depths of the sea, that they should offend one of these little ones. What you think going to happen? See, our biggest problem is we got to give everybody restitution that do us wrong, and we feel like we got to come and we got to try to avenge and fight ourselves or prove how right or how just we are. All we got to do is just stand on his word. Eventually, our righteousness will prove us out. Our father Jacob, when he was accused that he had stole Laban's God, what did he tell him? Search him. Let my righteousness prove me out. Let one of the brethren judge. That's how we came up with brothers judging. Because of our father Jacob, he let one of the brothers judge. Let my righteousness judge me and prove me out. When it came down to him keeping his father's sheep, came to his father-in-law's sheep, let my righteousness prove me out. You give me the worst of it, and I'll let you take the best. You know what's amazing with Paul? He asked you, when it come down to being the fraud, he want to know why you won't take the worst of it. Where you get it from? We so busy at trying to con and manipulate and thinking we got to try to fight to prove ourselves. We don't realize if we do what he said, vengeance in mind, said the Lord, I'll repay. We keep thinking we got the Bible. Even tell us, beloved, avenge not who? Because then God can't fight. You can't expect me to jump on sin and I'm going to jump on him and beat him up and did something. Then I'm saying, now God is going to come get you. Don't put me in it. You done moved on your own. You done your own stuff. Had you let it been on me, I could have went down and got his seed and his seed seed. You don't know how it could have worked. You'd have left it to me. But since you jumped and you moved and you decided judgment, now it's going to come back and you got to wait on restitution on yourself. Whatever y'all do, it's good for us to come here and we learn it to focus, because a lot of times y'all going to think your righteousness is going to come from you keeping the Sabbath, the feast days, and Wednesday night, midweek service, all these different things you're doing. They're not going to prove your righteousness. Y'all come here to be taught so you can manifest righteousness. That's why I get on y'all when y'all come here and you go to sleep, because when you sleep, you're in an unconscious state. And that's where you're supposed to make your change from. That was the purpose of him coming, an open blind eye, because you can't see. The same thing if you sleep. I can hear in my sleep because you are an idiot. You're not hearing in your sleep. You're unconscious. There's a reason why he put you. If he could hear, he could have told the apostle, don't worry about it. You don't have to be awake because you can hear in your sleep. You sleep, so therefore you're going to wind up falling into temptation because you're going to miss something that's going to be pertinent to your salvation. That's why we come here, folks. We got to come here to strategize. Look at how we wind up falling out here and faltering in front of these people. Because we keep thinking we got to fight it. We got to try to manipulate like other people do. We don't consider there's a God fighting for us. At that 45th chapter of the book of Isaiah. Where you at? Verse 25. Other brother, give me Acts of the Apostles chapter 13. Give me about verse 37. Listen to the book.
In the Lord shall all the seed of Israel be justified and shall glory.
Y'all hear that? In the Lord shall all the seed of who?
All the seed of Israel be justified and shall glory.
All right. Acts of the Apostles chapter 13 by verse 37. Make it 36. Listen to the book.
For David, after he had served his own generation by the will of God, fell on sleep and was laid unto his fathers and saw corruption. But he...
What did he mean, saw corruption?
Died, decayed.
His body decayed. You see, that definition, you take corruption. I mean, David was fired by that devil. You said some corruption. They go and they said, we found out the city of Atlanta got corruption in it. What that mean? They turned to dirt?
Crooked.
Huh? Crooked, something wrong. So you take that definite, it looked like David was crooked. When he saw corruption, I mean his body wound up deteriorating away. That's a different when we saw Yeshua. His body saw no corruption. Listen.
But he, whom God raised again, saw no corruption.
Listen.
Be it known unto you, therefore, men and brethren.
Listen to what he told you.
That through this man.
What happened?
Is preached unto you the forgiveness of sins.
And why important is that to us, Brandon?
And by him, all that believe are justified from all things.
Y'all hear that? Sound like some of what Isaiah said. Israel going to be justified by this man. Which would make sense of Paul coming and letting our forefathers know this. See, the difference, again, with us, with finding. And I think when we find our similarities, then we find some things we can compare ourselves, then we can find our shortcomings as well. Because the difference in why you will see the transformation with these people, when you know the law and you hear certain things, it'll spark. Now you're telling them about this man, you'll be justified. That ties into what Isaiah told us. Who you think he was talking to? Israel. This is what our promise told him. So here we are, people knowing the law with the old store. Now we're hearing the new store, which is going to make us come back to consider the old store. This would make Jews like Abira go back to search the epistle letters. Because of the new, they would have to go eat the old store, which was already a part of the covenant. This would start to spark things in these people. The missing puzzles make sense, even when you find a man like Apollos. Eloquent where? Where was he eloquent at? Scripture. Eloquent in the scripture. Fervent in the spirit. Because the words I speak, they are spirit and they are life. Only knowing the baptism of John. But once he had been expounded away more perfectly, he was able to mightily convince the people. And that by the scripture, that Jesus was the Christ.
Amen.
Because of the new, it came and compared him to go back and he could see and put perfection on the old. Mm. That's why we here. There are a lot of things we miss. When we got here and we were established, colonized, indigenized. Are there any disputers before I move further on this word? Thank you. We were pressed upon the New Testament, which was good for us. Because it made no sense to give us the old. Had we been illuminated and enlightened in the old, how could we have actually worked in the old when we were captive, we were slaves? How could we tell our masters, hey, well, now we got to start keeping the Sabbath and the feast day and the holy day? We were taught New Testament big on forgiveness, and they used that to say, forgive your oppressors. Everything we taught about new was forgive and bless and things going to come. But now, after you've gone so far with these epistle letters, guess what they force you to do?
Okay.
Go back to the old store. It forced us to go back and get into some people say, don't worry about that. Just keep dealing with the new. But the new doesn't actually make sense or come complete until you go back to get the old. Now we come back now to put perfection on what we learned. A lot of things we spend a lot of time on, even with finding Christ, which is important, which is essential. But there are a lot of attributes we hadn't yet learned. We've been so big on restoring and getting and receiving. We hadn't considered in order to receive, there's got to be a giving. There's got to be a loss. You can't regain some if there's not been a loss. If we go to court, car wreck, I'm driving, paying attention, text, bam, I slam into Brandon. I'm not giving you a dime. I'm not giving Brandon one dime. Brandon, because of his education, he gets a lawyer. His lawyer wants to take me to court. Now I'm what's called the defendant. Brandon, by definition, would be the plaintiff. Now, the whole purpose and what the judge has to look at when he's hearing the case, what happened and was there a loss? He has to value that loss to see what should be owed from the defendant to make the plaintiff whole. Makes sense? Well, now we look at this man is looking at what has been taken from us, and now he's got to look at the loss, and he's got to assess the damage and say, this is what should be given to you. Well, the plaintiffs, we're saying that the defendants have damaged us. They've damaged our reputation. These people have stolen from us. These folks have indigenized. They've stolen our God. They've taken our land. Even Isaiah, they testified, we only possessed it but for a little while. Now, you telling me I hit Brandon 2014 call, and I'm going to go to court and my lawyer who's going to argue for me, defend me, saying, Judge, I want to get some parts off of a 1964 that should fit his car. not going to work. It's not going to be equal. It's not equivalent. It's too new. We got to restore it back to where it was. And that's what we're looking at now. We're looking to be made whole. When Christ came and asked the man he found, would thou be made partial? Got to be made whole. But our problem become we've set the fight, we set the mark, and we count to say, to me, this equal. If my kids can go to the same school, that's going to erase all your damage. If I could just sip out the water fountain, that's going to erase your damage. If I can walk in and vote, that's all I want, Anthony, before I die. Oh, they were old blessed to that. Before I die, if I can just vote. You've assessed it, and that's your equivalent to everything we lost? We lost to God. You can't give me nothing less than God. We lost to religion. You can't give me any less than a true religion. Let's look at the damage. Look at your home. Look at your kids. Now we look at this book, we start to find out we've been damaged pretty bad. Any judge that's fair, that's righteous, and he do things that are right, he got to sit around and assess it. Look at, I do things that are right. It only makes sense. I got to restore. The apostle asked, what thou do what now? Restores to what? Because you judge. The man is judging you. Are you going to restore and make me whole? You're sure in the 18th chapter of the book of Matthew, but 18th chapter of the book of Luke, he talked about there was a judge that feared not God nor regarded man. But when this woman continued to plead with him, he said, let me avenge her lest she weary me. I don't know how to pray. You don't know how to pray and call on God. I'm asking God, I want to be restored. Man, I'm not asking for nothing wrong. I hit a 2014. You don't want no 1969 parts. It only makes sense. Put me back the equivalent. That's why we need a God. There are some situations you can't handle. You got to take and you got to get due process done. We sat around and you going to make a judgment call saying it's equivalent to what we've done, what we suffered, what we lost. Look at where we at. You know what's amazing? Y'all serve false gods better. You wouldn't have dealt with no Baptist church and went to sleep. You'd never pull this junk y'all pull in one of these other apostolic churches. You know what protocol is. You know what, dude? You know what you've been told. You know what men and women date, what they ask everybody to give. You know what your dues is. They set dues for your behind. You behind on your dues. Even when I was in the choir, you paid dues. You ain't got your choir dues. You're not singing this Sunday, Lanita. She wanted to catch her dues up. We were obligated to you. Now we come along, we become free in God and get knotted. Now we come slacking our servitude. We think he released us from something. He's trying to get us back to somewhere. This is what our occupation is. Everything we've done been suffered and lost. Even when Jacob got his family and said, let us go up to the house of Bethel, he knew you're going to suffer long. Put it away. You're going to dwell in God's house. You got to put something away. When he was commanded, 35th chapter, he was told to dwell, meant stay there. David testified in the 23rd Psalm, the Lord is my who? I shall not. He made me. He leaded me. Yeah, he restored my soul. Yeah, he restored. Don't y'all turn them Bibles. Don't y'all use them phone and them laptops to try to find. Yay. Uh-huh. Hold on. You were taught this in the Baptist church. How many of y'all were Baptist? You quoted this on Easter. He restored my soul. He led me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear. For thou art who? Not who? They do what? Thou doth what? Where? Thou anointest my who? Surely shall follow me, and I shall do what? Where? For hell. Why you think he told Jacob, dwell there? Where you think David come from? He told Jacob to dwell there at Bethel. Stay. Basically told the man to tarry. First time we heard that, huh? Told a man to tarry. Luke 24, 45. Wonderful Savior. But look what David told you going to happen. Yea, do I walk through the what? Or the shadow? Everybody going to live good, godly, going to suffer persecution. Everybody live godly, going to suffer persecution. David wasn't going to be exempt, was he? Otherwise, he wasn't living right. Y'all know how we account living right. Everything happened, children blessed. Matter of fact, I'm too blessed to be stressed. Matter of fact, I'm so anointed, I had to be appointed. I get it how it go. What is it? Too anointed to be what? Disappointed? I don't know how it go. We're blessed in the... I told you, you might holler, you messed in the city, you messed in the field, you messed in your clothes, and you need to go. Don't sit around there and program to make a fool out of us. All that we do, cast, pull out every sickness. All he done, insulin needles in him. Folk got to walk out in a minute, go and tip to get the blood pressure and get the done diabetes back up. So we don't quit singing these lies around him. That's right. They're telling how they, but they program us. We have to fall and sing their stuff. They pull us in and make us privy to their lies. Then what makes it so bad? Liars singing it. Drunks. Drug heads, cigarette smokers singing it. Best singers you ever heard. Fornicators and adulterers. Whoremongers. We sit up here and we giving honor to these people instead of sitting around giving the honor that come from God. That's the only honor that should count for us. Looking for a lifestyle. They can tell about other people. How you ought to listen to other preachers? I know. So I said, we keep the Sabbath. We do say, what kind of lifestyle he got? God be using him. What kind of lifestyle he got? People don't ask about that. You know the first thing they ask? Y'all keep that feast day holy? I'm going to come over to y'all church. Y'all mean, some of our folks, they kept, they were liars. Idolatry worshipers. We fall for this stuff. What's the lifestyle? What's the protocol? Go to any Israelite churches. He would walk in with pants, so the earrings, all this stuff. And they Old Testament, they live off of it. Say, explain to me why Jacob made them take it off before they went in. How you manage to let them keep it on? Because they do what they want to do. And just like Yeshua said, but they make the word of God of none effect by your tradition. Where we get them tradition? Come as you are. Where he ever told her that? Where he ever told her, come as we are? No good and well, you're going to make a change. You know, good and well, you're going to have to be a transformation. You have to give up something. That's the problem why so many of y'all sit in limbo. Because you actually still got that same come as you are syndrome that you got from these false worship churches. You can't come as you are. You got to make a change. Jacob, there ain't no way in the world you going to receive nothing from God sitting here with that mess on. Come on, son. This is Luke 24:44 be fine. Come on, son. Listen.
And he said unto them, these are the words which I spake unto you.
While
I was yet with you.
That all things
must be fulfilled.
Which were written.
In the law of Moses.
And.
In the prophets.
And.
In the Psalms.
Concerning who?
Me.
Then.
Opened he their understanding.
That they might.
Understand the scripture.
And said unto them.
Thus it is written.
And thus.
It behooved Christ to suffer.
And to rise.
From the dead.
Other one, get me Genesis 35:1. The third.
Day.
And that repentance.
And remission of sins.
Should be preached.
In his name.
Among who?
All nations.
Beginning what?
At Jerusalem.
But listen.
And ye are witnesses of these things.
And so.
And behold.
I do what?
I send the promise of my Father upon you.
But do what?
Tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem.
Until.
Ye be endued with power from on high.
At Luke. At Genesis 35:1. Listen to the book.
And God said unto Jacob.
This is 35:1 of the book of Genesis. God said unto Jacob, do what?
Arise, go up to Bethel and dwell there.
What did dwell mean? Stay. What did Yeshua tell the apostle to do to Jerusalem? Stay in Jerusalem. Stay in Jerusalem. In the 8th chapter of the book of Acts of the Apostle, let's see what happened right quick. We'll come back to 35:1. Acts 8:1. Little brother got me Genesis 35:1. Let's see what happened here in Acts 8:1. Listen.
And Saul was consenting unto his death.
Yeah.
And at that time, there was a great persecution against the church which was at Jerusalem.
Listen.
And they were all scattered abroad throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. And devout men carried Stephen to his burial.
Oh, they were all where now?
Throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles.
Only made sense. Only made sense. Man told me to stay there. Back at the 35th chapter. Genesis 35 and 1. Listen to the book.
And God said unto Jacob, Arise, go up to Bethel and dwell there, and make there an altar unto God that appeared unto thee when thou fleddest from the face of Esau thy brother.
Listen.
Then Jacob said unto his household and to all that were with him, Put away the strange gods that are among you, and be clean, and change your garments.
That's amazing. I have memory brain folks in here with junk on. I just figure I just get them in there and then let pastor save them. Take a look at them. I'm praying in the house of God. I already know you're going to be saved like that. That's why a lot of times it be no effect for people. Because you come in with the same junk you got on in the world. This is part of, that would mean they would have had to repent. Be clean and change your garment. Hold you got. 2 Corinthians 7 1. Matter of fact, make it 6:17. 2 Corinthians 6:17. I don't know what any of this has to do with anything. I can help you. I don't know why everybody fight me. I can help you. See, the problem with Smithfield, he don't let God do nothing. I'm letting God. When I preach his word and I do what he said, God working. He can't work outside that word. This 2 Corinthians 6:17. Let's see what the promise was. He told them, Behold, I send the promise of my father upon you, but tarry in the city of Jerusalem. Let's see what the promise was. Listen.
Wherefore, come out from among them.
And be ye what?
Separate.
Said who?
The Lord.
So Jacob left labor. Come on, no way to be saved now. He had to get back. And be ye what?
Separate.
Even when it came down to the cattle, he kept his cattle with his, he kept Laban's cattle with his cattle.
No.
Got to separate them. That's why he was blessed. Y'all know the problem here with y'all? Try to fit in. So you fit in some kind of way, God can get you and me fit in. No, you got to be separated. He even knew when he got the cattle, only way for it to work, God going to bless me, I'm about to separate my cattle from your cattle. I take the ring seat, you take these right here. You take the spot, I take the whole. Whatever we got to do, it got to be different. One thing going to happen, then we got to be separated. We got to be separate. Even if it came down the lot, when there was a stove, when both of them fighting, when both of them, their herdsmen kill arguing, Abraham has to listen. This shouldn't be. Listen, I'll go this way, you go that way, or you go whichever way you want, I'll go the opposite way. We got to separate. It ain't going to work. It's just not going to work. When the Lord looked to bless him, he wasn't blessing nobody but Abraham at that time. You got to separate. Lot was his nephew. That's the problem we got. Y'all can't, you know what's amazing? We keep coming in because the average of y'all hold up, I already know where it is. Y'all kids, your marriage, and your finance. And some of it is yourself. This is going to be the average of y'all fall. All of you in here and watching this going to hell, you under one of these categories. Y'all can't leave or separate from nothing, can you? Your stuff going to be your downfall. This right here was part of repentance. How they going to go to the house of God with this stuff? You got idolatrous God. You got earrings. You got all this stuff. Jacob had to know something. Didn't know to tell him to take it off. Someone had to compel him and say, take it off. We even talked about even with Noah. How would Noah know to take what was clean and unclean if he hadn't been told something? It makes sense. Even with Israel later on and let them know, take away the earring, the bracelet, those apparel. Take all that stuff off. Take out all that junk. Take it off. Because we going, our God was going to build a house for us. And we going to be in here. You can't be in here with that junk. That stuff wind up being attached to your heart. Some of y'all fashionably going to hell. Listen to the book. Wherefore?
Come out from among them.
And be ye.
Separate, saith the Lord.
Come on.
And touch not the unclean thing.
That's why Jacob didn't want nothing to do with them, God. Get rid of them. He ain't going to let them take it. Put that junk away. Get rid of it. It's unclean. We'll tote crosses. We'll do it for them. We'll tote praying hands for them. Whatever they need. Tell them don't even touch the unclean thing. And what you'll do?
And I will receive you.
That's why God won't receive. He literally, we go in the house of God, the purpose of going, we'll try to receive something from God. Now, how are we going to receive something from God when we hadn't even walked according to what's been applicable that he done told us to do to the word? You ain't even applied with the word, and you sit up here wanting the spirit. When did you ever comply? Come out. Hadn't done that. Abraham left his. Be ye separate. Abraham did all these things. Jacob them did these things. And touch not. That's why he said, you check. Jacob, whole insight with this. That junk shouldn't be among me. Search it. Let the brethren draw. It's not mine. And whoever you find out, you can kill them. Because they shouldn't have it. You know me though, Pastor Murphy, I go to hell. Because he be saying how these preachers ought to go to hell if they do such and such and stuff. Jacob looked at whoever got it because they shouldn't have it. Not if they with me. They shouldn't have it. Y'all don't think like that. Some of that stuff y'all be thinking, that little mercy grace you got. You got no mercy grace. That's your sobbing stuff. You trying to cover up your stuff and you know you're going to hell. Right, y'all don't be moving me with that stuff. Right, y'all move like y'all over compassion. Nigga, please. Compassion is his word. How you going to be more compassionate than his word? Y'all, some of y'all here think y'all got more spirit than Jesus do. Y'all know no more love and more compassion this man had. This man done pleaded and called us all things. I done stretched out my hand to a disobedient, a gainsaying nation. All you ever done was dispute. All you try to do is cover up your done lifestyle and try to use other people. I seen that junk out. Y'all ain't moved me with none of that junk y'all pulling. Sound like y'all so worried about other folk. Why you ain't worried about your done self? First worry should come on me. But that's a good sob story. That's how they do it in the street. That's how sinners feel better about themselves. Every Thanksgiving, they don't go with their family. They go work at Jose Feed the Hungry. Christmas, what they do, they buy gifts for people they don't know. Who you buy gifts for Christmas, Leon? That's what I thought. You're not more saved than me. That's their justification. Can't buy nobody no gift for Christmas. It's a pagan holiday. That stuff don't move nobody. Say, if you love me, do what?
Keep my commandments.
Go work at Jose Feed the Hungry. Go get with the Red Cross. He never told me to go give him no Red Cross. Got a cross anyway on. Leave that junk alone. Get my done blood and give it to a vampire. Man, I told her clearly, what do you love me? Keep my commandments. And John told her, what did he tell about his commandment? Must be grievous. You ain't done it. The Bible said the way is grievous to him that forsaketh the way. That's what is grievous. That, most of y'all had a hard time because you forsake it. Listen, anytime you may do something you don't want to do, it's hard. Our child's stomach ain't want to, because they ain't want to do it. Shut your mouth, went on and done it, been through with it. Ain't that right? But when it grieving, you don't want to do it, it's hard on you. And you know who he said it with? Transgressor. Hard to a transgressor. Boy, it was hard to get up this morning because of transgressor. All right. Because the book compels us to be him. So why was it so hard to come? Lord, no, I had to fight it this morning to get him. What I just said? See, you be saying stuff and don't even know it. Don't even know what you be saying. Whew, Lord, got to beat me this feast to try to make it. I'm telling you. It's going to be hard for me to make this feast. What I just said? What did it say about his yoke? Easy. And his burden?
Right.
Church got me just wore out. Got me straddled more than I could bear. What I'm saying? See, a lot of stuff people say, don't even know what they be saying. Folks thinking, I said, have I been saying that? Because he's so working on it. Yeah, I know. I know. Stuff you better learn, though, ain't it? But start learning what you say. You better start breaking what you're doing.
Yeah.
They can't do it. He said, it's easy. My burden is light. Ain't no way in the world your burden pull be harder than they ever been. He said, mine light. I can deal with it. I don't know about y'all. I ain't taking on nothing make me want to get this up. Anything, the more calm, look at the more, I got to get more anchored than anything. Scare me to be out there dealing with no God on my side. I need a God. I look at me, I was a fool. I've been fighting the whole world with no God on my side. I was a victim to these people. It's the best way you ever live in your life. Come on, son, finish this up. Wherefore, come out from among them, be ye separate, said the Lord, and touch not unclean thing. And I receive you, and ye shall be my...
And will be a father unto you.
And I'll be a father unto you. And
ye shall be my sons and daughters.
Said
the Lord Almighty.
What happened with that?
Having therefore these promises. Dearly beloved.
Let
us
cleanse
ourselves
from all
filthiness of the flesh
and
spirit.
Perfecting what?
Kodesh in the fear of God.
So I wonder what Jacob was doing here, 35:1. Listen.
And God said unto Jacob, Arise, go up to Bethel and dwell there, and make there an altar unto God that appeared unto thee when thou fleddest from the face of Esau thy brother.
Come on.
Then Jacob said unto his household and to all that were with him, put away the strange gods that are among you.
And do what?
Be clean.
And do what?
Change your garments.
Filthiness of the flesh and spirit. He was just told him, just take the clothes off. You know, they ain't going to do nothing. Because something in your heart made you get it. Something in my heart made me commit fornication. Something in my heart made me lie and smoke weed and drink. And everything I did, stole. So it made sense to change the clothes. Put a suit on and come to Sunday worship, which was wrong all by itself, but just using it as a premise. Hadn't nothing changed in my heart. I just changed my clothes. Don't wear dope dealer stuff. But dope dealing was still in my heart. He knew something allowed you and made you get it. Because he looked at it. I didn't have it. Something in my heart allowed me. I didn't have it. Jacob didn't have the earrings on. Jacob didn't have it. He didn't have it. Not my God. He didn't want Laban God. All he wanted was what was fair. Give me my wife and my children and let me get back to my father's house. That's all he wanted. Something in their heart made them look at, I'm going to take my gods where I go. Almost, you can go and be somewhere and still be your own person and have your own thing. He looked at not when you go up to God's house. This has hurt us over the years. This is how parents sit around and they let their little gay nephew, whoever come to the family union, all sit in here and let him bake and bring stuff. I ain't never no sister. Let's just tell the truth because it all stemmed from the church. Don't judge. Don't try to change people. Let God do it. All Jacob looked at, he done made a judgment to tell them they had to be clean. To tell you to be clean and to say, I made a judgment, I feel like you're dirty. I think, so what did he do? He was judging based upon appearance and actions. And he made a call for a judgment saying, you're going to have to get rid of that, you're going with me. Not us. Let the crackhead child stay in the house because I'd rather my crackhead child be in him to be out there in that street where they can get killed. Can't stay here. That's what Jacob let them go. That stuff can't be here. Oh, it was years ago, black parent, your child selling dope? Well, they can't stay at mom. You can't stay at him? We've changed. Let them stay here and hopefully the Lord changes. No, all we got to pray. Listen, church, it's time to pray. We be praying, but you got to get off the premises. You can't bring that stolen junk here. You got to go. That was Jacob. Look, if we going up to God's house and we going to be there, then you had to repent. You had to repent and you had to get rid of stuff. It's important. And you know what hurt us? This is why a lot of you guys have procrastinated so long, because you keep thinking, pray with your stuff. That's not helping. I can't pray with the eye of God right here. He ain't going to hear it. It's not going to work. It's still in his face. He can't do nothing with it. That's going to make good. I'm going to go to my wife with a woman. Let me just use California. Come on for a second. I'm just using for a second, sweetie. Hypothetically, this is later. I'm cheating on going to my wife. Can you take me back? I'm going to try to do better. What's the problem? Still right here in my face. In her face. And then God looking at you sitting here praying, Lord, save me. Cigarette, alcohol, drug, lying, adultery, shagging up. Lord, I need a change. I can't hear you. He told us in the 59th chapter of the book of Isaiah, the Lord hand not short that he cannot say. Neither his ear heavy that he cannot hear. But your what? Has separated between you and your God. And your. Have hid his face from you so that he would what? I'm going to be an atheist. Because ain't no God. If it was a God, why he ain't answer my prayer? If he was a God, why he ain't answer my prayer there if he was a God? I'm not considering though. What am I doing the reason he not answering my prayer? What's my lifestyle? Just like the man said, we know that God hear if not who, but if any man turn and be a worship of him, he ain't had enough sense to know that. Not us. Ain't no God. Or flop to another downgrade religion. Never consider what am I doing. Immediately there's no God. Come sit here, can't get a wife. Can't move from an $8 hour job. Your shoes ain't selling. You're banging a 60-something-year-old woman. Ain't no God. People, nobody want to look at what am I living, what am I manifesting, what am I doing, the reason I have no spirit. Oh, I'm false. Why else I ain't got the Holy Ghost? Well, the Ruach Kodesh. He false. Why I ain't got it? He ain't looking at what you're doing. The apostle, when they saw the man born blind, they knew he must have done something or apparent. See, we don't want to do that. I don't know what God doing. That's a problem. We Jew, we supposed to know. Our book told us in the book of Amos, the 3rd chapter, surely the Lord doth except he reveal it. I don't know what. I don't know what he's doing. Which would mean what? Nobody want to deal with that duty. Because the Lord just doing so much. No man knoweth the way of the wind. He's not talking about no wind, stupid. He talking about we supposed to know. We see this stuff coming. These are signs. These are things given us. That's why I'm sitting here letting y'all know. I know what y'all problem is. But y'all going to try to put it on something else. When you don't want to do it and you don't want to comply, don't ever sit down and address yourself. I know what it is. It's rooted. That's why. I should have known it was rooted. Why else dare I can't be saved? Rooted. I ain't gonna never get that mirror like the book said. Look into the perfect law of who?
Liberty.
And what is the law, what would the law supposed to resemble? Why am I looking in the mirror? I'm in front of the mirror and I'm seeing rooted. Because I'm not looking in the mirror around me. I know what y'all guys use. Y'all try to use other people for why you in your dilemma. Nobody no excuse for why you in your dilemma but you. You allow, you let, and you let that be a stumbling block to yourself because you don't want to deal with the real culprit, yourself. You're going to be your own demise. You're going to be your own fault, and you're going to be the one to drag you to hell because you don't want to deal with reality. Everybody dealing with something, baby. Everybody suffers something, but everybody don't fall down and die and cry because they suffer. It's just a part of life. Whether you cry or you laugh, situations don't change until you make change. I know because I've been guilty. I've been guilty of crying and complaining about things, but things don't change until you make change. Why you cry, nothing stops. Ask a woman when she getting raped, does a rapist say, you crying? Whoa. I wasn't expecting you to be crying. So what? He feels from it. Because that shows just how much more dominance he have over you. How much more fear he invokes upon you. When an animal is attacked by a predator, it's crying and whining don't make the animal stop. His whole thing is to try to make sure he kill it and subdue it. So why you think the devil gonna let you go? You gotta get in your mind. I gotta make change if I want change. If I want the spirit, I gotta do things that appertain to the spirit. And that's what you guys hadn't done. You think just hearing, spirit come. You've done absolutely very minimal to no application. Explain how that works. I have a medication that can make a person white, right here in this bottle. Instantaneously turn white. I will sit this right beside Rudy. Hypothetically, you want to be white. Sit that beside it, and it'll turn you white. On that bottle, it says he has to apply it. Rudy has the bottle. The bottle says right beside Rudy, just watch Rudy turn white. Can y'all see him lighting up right now? What would be the problem? No application. In order to obtain the spirit, we have been taught what's mandated, what's necessary, without any type of escape, you got to do. And you've not done it. Explain me exactly when you're looking for your change. You would do the same thing hypothetically Rudy do, sit beside it and think it's going to jump outside the ball and work. It's not going to do that. Not going to do it. When we were told him, come out from among them, your responsibility. Be ye separate, your responsibility. How I separate? I've been taught by the word the do's and as and minister by saying, and the do-notses. Now, when I see people that's in the do-notses, why am I still with these people? Well, I don't want to move too fast because God might be trying to use me. No, separate. Now, this is application. Touch not. You will help me take this rugged cross up here, and we're going to do this skit plate and that. I'm not going to be able to help you. Touch not. Taste not. Handle not. For all other pair, I got this. You want to taste a piece of this wicked pie? It's delicious. Taste not. We know that. Why would I be eating it? You like devil food cake, don't you? That's just a name. It ain't literally. Why did you even? I'm trying to think. Who came up with devil food and want to give it to somebody? Touch not, taste not, handle not, for all other perishing with the using thereof. After the tradition of men. Showing this has been a prayer. When you tell the people about Thanksgiving, pray about damn tell something. Thanksgiving is not a pagan holiday. Our forefathers, when they came over here, sat down with the Indians, and they sat down to celebrate after the first harvest, and they started to make this dinner, and they ate the turkey. And they talked you to do it because this is what we've done. This is tradition. This is how people just. So you trying to tell me all the people who done ate Thanksgiving dinner, quote unquote, going to hell. Christmas dinner, going to hell. People always trying to talk over tradition. Tradition means something that's been passed down. This is why a lot of y'all get dragged into stuff. Now you start thinking, well, then my grandmama ate it. Well, maybe I don't think Granny going to hell. Stop trying to overthink stuff. The word is what it is. He ain't trying to think. Then now, I can't be a part of this because he teach my grandmama going to hell. Do I teach your grandmama going to hell or the book says she's going to hell? It's easy to put it on, I teach. I say she going to hell, or he, I say your granddaddy going to hell because your granddaddy was a pastor. He was a good man. No, that's what it teaches. And you got to get past all these other people you so hooked into that made error. All these people have heard some form of the truth. They just refuse to do application, just like a lot of you doing. If you die and you go to hell, what's going to be the problem? No application or very minimal. Use some one time, and it told you to use over the course of 7-15 days. Some medication said must eat or complete the whole bottle, and you've only done half. I feel better, though. I don't think I'm going to need the rest of this. And you know what wound up happening? A lot of diseases stay dormant, and later on, they reoccur. That's what happened with sin. You start listening. I'm doing better already. I ain't got to do all the rest of that stuff. I did enough already. This good right here. Now that sin, that evil heart has lied dormant in you, and later on, you come right back to manifest it again. I already know what y'all problem is. You come in earnest, you ready to do everything I taught. Once you've done enough, I'm free. Don't taste like liquor, just doo-doo now in my mouth. I must have changed. You like wake up and smell, have alcohol and cigarette on my breath and crack. It's just duty. I'm clean. I must have the spirit. You have to be clean or to receive the spirit. This is where you guys mess up at. Luke 11:22. We're going to finish that Jeremiah, that Genesis. I'm going to get ready to let y'all go. Is anybody getting anything out of this today? I really hope so. Because you know what? It would make no sense for us to go this far and taking what we've taken. And you sit here and you go. There's a lot of people watching me going to hell. A lot of people send money here. That's not the answer. Sending your money here ain't salvation. Salvation lies in application of the word belief. But if you don't believe in something, why would you do it? I don't believe in the boogeyman. That's why I go out in the dark. What you doing, stupid? It's dark outside. The boogeyman will get you. Because I don't believe it. Well, we're not going to say, I don't believe it. Two come out. You know you put that tooth under your pillow. The tooth fairy going to give you some money. I'm not going to do it because I don't believe it. Okay? I tell you what you have to do in order to obtain the spirit. You don't do it. What's the problem? I appreciate y'all. You don't believe it. Mark already told you, well, he that believe in he'll baptize. He that believe it not. All right, we got it. We got it. If that was actually a boogie man, I ain't believing, I went outside, what's going to happen? That's my fault. I was told one. Since he don't exist, I don't care about him. Nothing can happen. And I go outside. God exists. You've been told not to do something or to do something. You hadn't done it. Problem is, you don't believe. Now, what's going to wind up happening? You're going to wind up going to hell. See, we got to break this down to a lowest common denominator so people can finally break past that pole of committing sin. Quit thinking y'all all right. You not all right. People, y'all saying, I don't want to be pressured. Let me go get a wild animal and put it behind you. And you take your done time getting away from it. Your behind will not be properly getting up. You will be farting and tearing up and duking and urinating. All that is saying, why you yell and scream and tears shoot sideways out your eyes? Hurling these pews, trying to get away. Am I correct? Now, why won't we have that much fear for God? More than we should have over ravenous beasts. Some of y'all have fear. How many of y'all got fear of rats? I can't stand them little things. I keep standing on a little bit of teeth down by my ankle. How many of y'all got fear of dogs? When it come, you break your neck trying to get away. You ain't fear what it can do. Why we don't have that type of fear for this man knowing when he come? We see a sign say, beware, bad dog, mean dog, danger. Whoo, that's ain't even seen the dog. But you know what? You're not stupid. That sign told you, and you know there is a probability that dog gonna come. That dog is near. You sit here and read your Bible, and you've been told there's a God coming back that's gonna kill you, that's gonna destroy you, and gonna put you in the hell forever. You ain't moved. You ain't moved. And that's because you don't believe. Because you don't believe. You got to be pressured and pushed to the point to realize it. In your mind, you think you believe. You say, I do believe. Why else am I here? Because you need somewhere to stay and occupy time. You're hoping just in case, if you're wrong or right, you can cover yourself. But there's no real motivation for you to try to escape here because you don't actually believe there's a hell. You don't actually believe there's a judgment. People just live as long as they do, and then people die. So get what you can get while you're here. And whatever happens in the ever after later on, and you just have to deal with it then until you meet him to his face. And you wind up going to hell, and you realize this was a really poor decision you made. Now, if you say you believe, I'm expecting more application out of you guys. This is Luke chapter 11 at verse 23. Those that are watching me that don't have a pastor, I want you to immediately start the search. You need to get a pastor. Don't you be stupid. You need to get a pastor. You're going to wind up going to hell. Stop letting these people make a fool out of you. This is not going to save you. You need somebody to be a watchman over your soul. You need to be restricted. You need to be taught. Somebody you feel. Somebody going to teach you to feel God. I know there's a lot of them watch me. They listen because it's convenient. I'm not your pastor when it comes down to certain things you got to do. Them the things you want to you when somebody tell you and you had your conversation with your friends, you're a member of church, you're like, oh, I got me a church on the internet. I got a pastor I follow. That's that little way they try to sit right here. As Minister Bible said, try to transfer risk. Claim you got somebody you follow, but you don't do what you told. So you're not following me. As Jesus said, my sheep, hear my voice. I know them and what they do. They follow me. All my members follow me. So don't use me talking about I'm your pastor. You ain't following no band when I'm teaching. I'm telling people the truth because your soul on the line. You can't afford for people to keep telling you. It's too late in the evening to hear lies. Now you either want somebody to tell you the truth or you want to just go on somewhere and set a comedy club where you can just die and go to hell. And at this point, you need to be truthful with yourself. Oh, do you really know what it takes to be saved? Listen to the book. 11 and 23, book of Luke. Come on.
He that is not with me is against me.
And he that doth what?
Gathereth not with me.
Scattereth what?
Period.
And another right, he talked about he that gathereth not with me scattereth abroad. Come on, son.
When the unclean spirit is gone out of a man.
He doth what?
Walketh through dry places.
Seeking what?
Rest.
Finding what?
None.
And what happened?
He saith, I will return unto my house from whence I came out.
And what happened?
When he cometh, he findeth it swept and garnished.
And what happened?
Then goeth he and taketh to him seven other spirits more wicked than himself.
And the last?
And they enter in and dwell there, and the last state of that man is worse than the first.
And a lot of you have already achieved this. Because you sat too long clean. Clean is not the answer. Clean is the start. Some of y'all sold out for clean as spirit. He told them, now ye are clean. Did they have the spirit?
No.
They could have just went and sat and stopped. Later on, he wouldn't have had no reason to go and tell them to go and tarry in Jerusalem until they get the spirit. First of all, they had to get clean because the spirit can't get in an unclean temple. See, you guys need to know that certain things you put on your body, certain things that are in your body, prohibits the spirit. It's prohibited. It's not allowed, nor is it lawful that the spirit can enter your body. And you haven't been told this. You've only been told, just do what you can, keep showing up and coming, your change will come. You know where your change is going to come from? At a place that you gave too much money. That's where you get your change at. If you go somewhere and you purchase something and it costs 75 cents and you give them a dollar, your change is on the way. Your change is on the way. But when you come and apply yourself at a synagogue with a clean preacher preaching a clean word that's not faltering or backing off or compromising, where standard is set, your change will come when you set and you use application of the word. When you're willing to take off certain things you can't put on, there are certain medications or creams you put on. You know what they might ask you to do? To clean the surface before. Because germs and other things contaminate, it'll kill it. That's what happened with some of you. You tried to apply this application I've given you, and you haven't even cleaned the surface. You went and put on this balm that's been used for you to put on your sore, your illness, and you hadn't sat around the cassette. You never even cleaned the area. He knew sin is a deadly wound. In order to put on a medication and heal it, it's got to be first clean. Now, you know what you did. You go in here. You come. I've cleaned it. You say, whew, that's painful enough. Whew, it'll heal. That's what you settle for. You clean the surface, but you hadn't put the cream on. Look like it's getting better already just cleaning it. And that's the way you'll have it. It's too painful. Cleaning was enough for you. Clean. You took the cleaning, you should have got it just from now. No, you got to take the medication, which is application of the word. I want to make sure that we don't continue to do what we've done over the course of these many years. It's come in here, play, and think the spirit is going to rise. Come in here and sit stupidly, thinking that something miraculously is going to happen when you've done absolutely nothing to receive the spirit. There's no need to sit here. Do you actually know how dumb you would have to be to think that you sit here while you live in sin and commit things contrary to what he said? Spirit on the way. Spirit of stupidity. The spirit of dumbness. These are the only spirit you could be waiting on. There is no spirit to a man or a woman that has not cleaned themselves, that have not sat down and have obeyed. This is what Esaias kept asking. Lord, who had done what, brethren? And to whom is the arm of the Lord been revealed? Why did he ask that question? Because they had not all obeyed. He was looking at, no wonder they don't know. They hadn't obeyed. It showed in their behavior they have not obeyed. None of these people know who you are. The mere fact that he was talking about the arm, he told us, I'm going to uncover the arm. I'm going to make it known. And Isaiah looked and said, who knows it? If they've seen it, they hadn't obeyed. Who's seen it? Now I got to sit and ask, Lord, who has believed our report? Because I'm looking, trying to find out how many of y'all have obeyed. Because if you obeyed, there should have been a change. Clean is not saved. Clean is preparation for the spirit. And y'all guys, stop. You can't stop them. That's where you start at. The more you hear the word application, you keep applying. Look at how deep the wound of the sore is. Look at how long something has happened. Sometimes when a disease or a sickness has been there longer, then you have to use a different medication. If a person, years ago, Creole Motion, what you give a child for a cold? You don't give a crib motion if somebody got the flu. And you definitely don't give it to them they got pneumonia. There's some other things that's got it. Some of us have deeper wounds. We have more longevity in commencing, which means it's going to take a deeper applying or application. You got to do some scrubbing to get some things you got off that you've gotten on. And you got to be willing to do it when you sat down. Look at what do you look to yield from it? The spirit. Well, Cam really didn't have to do much. I just do what Cam did. I've been doing it a little longer than Cam. So I used to try to look at what it did. I know what it take to get me where I got to be. You know where you at. You know what kind of person you are. That's why we keep looking in the Word. When the Word comes, everybody here can identify themselves. You know, he ain't talking to me. Bald head joker. Stupid part of it, I'm not talking to you. The Word talking to you. I'm just a vessel standing here calling the Word. Who I wonder who told him. I told me nothing. I just preached the gospel. The gospel going to get every one of us in here. The Word going to open and reveal. The Bible says so manifest the things that are in our hearts. When the Word come, it find us. It's going to find you. That's what it's set to do. He said, I came to seek and to save that which is what? Why you think the Word come hit you? Because you're lost. I come to get, hey, get back on track. What you doing? But y'all get so hung up in some of the most frivolous stuff, and you don't even consider at the end of the day, got to look at my soul. Am I saved? Do I possess the spirit? And if not, what's hindering me? What am I willing to hold on to in this chain for salvation of my soul? If nothing else, you owe that to yourself. At the end of the day, you owe that to yourself. You owe that to your kids. You owe it to your mother, your father, your husband. You owe that to yourself to be saved. That's why I'm here. It's all about Tony. End of the day, it's all about Tony. So you don't care about nobody else. At that point, it's all about everybody that care about themselves will do the same thing I'm doing. Everybody that care about themselves. Go ahead and run there and see if I call you looking for you. I figure this. If you ran off and you left, that's what you thought about yourself. Why don't you see me trying to make you do nothing? If it ain't in your heart to do it, come on. Y'all try to look. Somebody talk me to stand there. I don't know, Leon. I might not be able to stay. And why are you wasting time? That's what you want to do. Do what you want to do then. Well, let me tell you something at the end of the day. I think too much of myself. I've never done that before in my life. Honestly, I thought I did. I've never loved me. I never thought anything about me. I was everybody fool, everybody punk. I never loved me. I thought I did. Things you buy and put on yourself are not signs of love. Things you get yourself and where you eat and where you shop at are not signs of love. A lot of times those are cover up for imperfections. The better the things, the more they cover imperfection, things you don't want to deal with. That's not signs of love. That's what we bought into the hype of society. Signs of love, loving myself is what I'm willing to do for myself, what I'm willing to restrain myself from. Because I consider self weak and yield and do that. There's a penalty at the end. So me and self had to say, I'm not going to do that. Flesh say, why not? Deal with it after. What come, let come what may. But loving myself say, we can't do that. That's only good for the moment. All that is temporary, self. We got to look at the things that are eternal. These are signs of loving myself. I have all the abilities to cheat, commit adultery, fornicate, or be homosexual, or to buy drugs. I do not smoke drugs because I can't afford it. I don't commit adultery because nobody else will be with me. I don't have the money to buy prostitutes. It's because I love myself enough to know at the end of it, there's going to be a judgment. As simple that might sound to y'all, I never had that type of restraint. If it was open, like I told, all I needed was air, that's opportunity. All I needed was room and space, I could do it. But loving myself came with some restraint. I never understood that. I heard people say, love yourself. What do they mean? Don't punch yourself. Well, I never used to beat myself in my face. I guess I love myself. I never sat down and restricted myself or stayed consistent to something before. Because I started to consider there's going to be another day. there's going to be a judgment for every behavior. So now in love, my son, to say, self, we cannot do it. We got to refrain. We're waiting on the promise. That's where you got to put yourself in. If you're waiting on the promise, we are taught that years or even with society today, people will make agreements in other religions or other ethnicities. They'll say, my newborn daughter, I'm going to give to your newborn son when he gets of age and she gets of age, which means I'm going to be responsible for her to make sure she lays with no other man. She can't date no other man. She can't go out with no other man. She can't deal with any other man or any other, because I promised her to somebody. We made a consensus agree. He's agreeing to give me something that I feel like that values to my daughter. Right? Well, in me restraining, keeping myself, I made a commitment that he's going to give me something I feel like that has value more than what I'm giving. You guys had never waited like that. That's why you ain't got no reason to wait. I feel like he give me about some junk. First thing come along, I give it up. First opportunity. But what me and him made an agreement on, I feel like it's of a value enough me to keep her, to restrain her until that day so I can receive the agreement promise. That's the mindset you guys got to get for the spirit. But if you don't wear of any value, you don't see a reason for you to be chained, you don't see a reason to obtain the spirit, then you'll continue to do what you've been doing. Finish the 35th chapter of the book of Genesis, I can let them go. I see they tired on me. One day, what he'll do, he'll give me some people that'll have some time. Some people, he'll do it. I know he will. He'll give me some people to say, I got to be saved at the end of the day. I have a congregation of people, not every one of you, but as a majority of y'all, y'all are real good with going to hell. I could tell it's showing your face. Y'all real good with going to hell. That's real dangerous. Because you only big and bad enough to go to hell now because you hadn't got there yet. Wait till you get there. You won't be so bad then. Listen to the book. This is the 35th chapter of the book of Genesis. You left out verse 2?
Verse 3.
Listen.
And let us arise and go up to Bethel, and I will make there an altar unto God, who answered me in the day of my distress.
Yeah.
And was with me in the way.
What was Jacob doing in there his distress? He was running where? Running from Esau. What was he doing? He said he answered him. That's what they were doing there at Pentecost. Supplication. Deep earnest prayer. So if I'm trying to kill you, there's a difference now when you start to seek. See how that worked? It's a difference. They were trying to seek a spirit because they were in pursuit. Listen, there was an uproar. These people had come along, and these folks started preaching about this new man called Jesus, who they said was the Son of God. You don't think nobody looking for you? They killed a man who you preached about. You don't think nobody looking for you? You don't think there's going to be no problem on you? I'm in deep distress. It's a need that I obtain this spirit. Because I'm dealing with the fact, eventually these people are going to kill me. He told me in the 16th chapter of the book of Luke that the time comes, John, that whosoever kill you going to suppose this they're going to do, because they had not known who? Me or the Father. So I already been told they're going to kill me. Esau going to pursue me. Then guess what I do? I got to get to Jerusalem. He got right back at the place where he sought him the first time. In the day when your brother was seeking your life, who you think these people were seeking? They were Jews. Their brother going to be seeking. This deep supplication in prayer. Get back to the place. Why do you think he told us to stand you in the way and ask for the what? Where's the what? When you find it. Why do you think Jacob was trying to get back? I done seen the land here of Laban. I done seen what he got. I started to consider Jerusalem. I need to get home. That's the good way. When you find it, check, I had to walk. I had to get back now. Huh? Now, guess what you're going to find when you get there? He got peace from Esau. Y'all ain't consider why we got to get back, but you got to know it's going to be some persecution. That's what he let them know. They're going to do this because they hadn't known me. They hadn't known the Father. So they had something to get them assured to make them seek. Because you're dealing with something where these people kill you. Today, it don't seem that serious. You know why? Because you're not that serious. Gosh, they might kill you right now. You good. And then you get a promotion and a raise. Anybody do nothing to you? Nobody going to bother y'all. You're not a threat to nobody. That thing gets really sealed in your heart, you're going to be a problem. All right? You're going to be a problem. See, Tony Smith a problem to him, but not a real problem, because people don't take me there and say, oh, hey, little tweet, little something, little YouTube. They ain't going to do nothing. So you start getting people in an uproar, it get to be a real problem. It'll be a real problem. Too many people start saying you pray. Too many people start making change. You start to deal with these politicians, start to deal with these governments and these churches. You got a problem. That was the problem with Yeshua. People say, well, I deal with politics. Because really, the average person is kind of real ignorant that listen to me. As they're really ignorant. Something stupid. Pilate, Herod, Caesar. Who are these people? Politicians. The Pharisees. Church officials. Why you think they can come together? Their own government. Why you think these people set up this country? They set, what is it called? I'm kind of ignorant. Separation of who now? Church and who? Church and who? Church and who? Because they know what these people do when they get together. They know what these people can do when they get together. They ain't stupid. The only stupid people is us. Only stupid people is us. And these churches come grab politicians, wheel them in before you and say, listen, it's our man. Church, we've been looking for somebody to bring us out. Get our kids out. This our judge. We got to get this judge on the bench. This judge going to help our kids out when they get arrested for these little petty drug crime because they're in bed together and these are the people they make deals with that's going to wind up hanging us later. And you know what happened? The leader does what? Persuade the people. That's what they did. They come and persuade the congregation. That politician when they come, you got the influence on these people that these people will do what you say. You shoot me in front and you tell me, I get in, I'm going to take care of you, and my deal going to be with you. I care about them niggas. Ask any of those churches that helped get them politician in, have they ever in their life got anything from that politician? The preacher has. You think that man or that woman finna lose their suit? See, fooling with you niggas? You know you a nigga, you gonna run your mouth and tell? Just said so, got my son out. And what you think I'm gonna do? Well, mine get locked up and go to jail by him. I'm going on the news. And I'm gonna tell about your son, they gonna lose their seat. So you can put this together. You think they stupid? Their deal gonna be with him, not with you stupid. The people that think I'm dumb are the real dummies. Because these people have no idea what these people are capable of doing. They know when they forefathers set this country up, they knew how dangerous they were. They knew how dangerous power could become unwielded. Electricity, fine. Use to light up these lights. Use to run this camera. Use for this system. Hit me a note right quick. Electricity. Take it and take the restrictions off of it. Power unwielded is dangerous. It can become destructive. And they knew these people become destructive. They have no conductor. They have nothing to come and to keep them in a certain currency level. They got nothing to come in to rule them. They have nothing that they have to answer to. And that's why they let the people know. Once the people got a government they couldn't trust, what were the people supposed to do? They were supposed to take the government down and establish another. Why don't our Bible tell us that? Because it was never set for us to rule. Our God, our way we're going to rule. It was never told us to take and tear and destroy and bring it down. Our God, because this is not power unwielded. See, I kill a lot of time up here with y'all. I really hate that I don't have more education. People would respect me. I could be somebody. People would listen to me when I walk places. They said, that's that guy. He knows stuff. He attended such and such university. He has degrees. Since I don't, I'm just a fool wasting time speaking. These people know they were dangerous. They know what they, why would you think these people seven say separation of church and state? Because they had enough sense to know what they did to that man. We are the only fools. You know, we hoping one day God give us a politician that can go in there. You idiot. He gave us one. Unto us, and the government shall be upon his who? We already got one. I don't know why the idiots even look for one. Why would we be looking for a politician that will come, that will bail us out? Only because we would be stupid. It's time to start thinking. Finish the 35th chapter. What verse?
Verse 4.
Come on.
And they gave unto Jacob all the strange gods which were in their hand.
Yeah.
And all their earrings which were in their ears.
Yeah.
And Jacob hid them under the oak which was by Shechem.
Mm-hmm.
And they journeyed, and the terror of God was upon the cities that were round about them.
Mm-hmm.
And they did not pursue after the sons of Jacob.
Yeah.
So Jacob came to Luz.
And what happened?
Which is in the land of Canaan.
And what happened?
That is Bethel.
That is Bethel, which is house of God. Come on, son.
He and all the people that were with him.
He and all the people that were with him.
And he built there an altar.
And what happened?
And called the place El Bethel.
Which is God, house of God. What happened, son?
Because there God appeared unto him.
That's amazing. On the day of Pentecost, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly, there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind. And it filled all of the who? House where they were sitting. What makes sense, he went there. Because there, he appeared. What do you think our premise of Pentecost and going to Jerusalem is for? The appearance. He appeared to him now. That's why when we pray, we always use their name. When you pray, we never forget Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. You can't forget them. These men put up the consensus. They put up the premise for us of why we go, why we seek the place for our behavior, why we strip ourselves of these things, why we can go on when adversities happen. What can make me keep going when I'm sick? What can make me keep going when I'm injured or I feel like I'm damaged beyond repair? I got to look at a man like Jacob who halted on that same leg. Yeshua himself came down at the 9th chapter of the book of Mark, verse 43. Boy, I wish I had a congregation of people that really feared this man, that really loved this man to the saving of the soul. Do y'all understand what kind of power that would be? Wield, not unwield power, wield power, mind movement of God. 9:43, book of Mark. Listen.
And if thy hand offend thee,
what?
Cut it off.
Come on.
It is better for thee to enter into life maimed
than to do what?
Having two hands to go into hell.
Yeah.
Into the fire that never shall be quenched.
Yeah.
Where their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched.
Yeah.
And if thy foot offend thee,
do what?
Cut it off.
Why?
For it is better for thee to enter halt into life
than to do what?
Having 2 feet to be cast into hell, into the fire that never shall be quenched.
Listen.
Where their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched.
What? Why is this important though? Because Jacob could have spent a whole lot of time on why the Lord didn't heal that leg. But it were better that Jacob went on with that leg like that and entered into life than it was for him not to have that injured leg and go to hell. You know, it's better for some of us, and I've said that how many times y'all did some of our situation, you're in the best situation. I mean, have I not told y'all that? Or this is the first time I heard it today. Best thing happened to us, your situation now. If it's got you where you here and it got you where you listening, I hope the Lord leave it on you. If it got you where you fearing, and they got you where you in dismay of your carnal life and you'll trust more in him, I pray God him remove it from you. Because it's going to be better that you enter into eternal life with that situation, that condition that you in, than for it to be fixed and you wind up going to hell where the maggots don't die and the fire not quenched. Listen to the book.
And if thine eye offend thee,
do what?
Pluck it out.
Why?
For it is better for thee to enter into the kingdom of
God. You know what? We spend more time on, Lord, just before I die, heal me. What if I heal you and you don't be saved? This man came telling the yea, and all that with little God are going to suffer persecution. I might lose an eye. I don't know. I thought about, can I get up and still do my job? I have no sight. I said, you know what? But then I still need to go back and look at the book every now and then and look over things. And, you know, you start looking. I start, and the Lord laid that in your heart. Is it more of you try to use that as an excuse? If I decide to bring you, try to act like it's going to limit you in your job, or if I put you in that situation, it can be to my glory. And I started to consider. It's because I worry about how I'm going to look to people. I'm worried about how it's going to be. I've been used to seeing. I never had to live blind. So I started attaching my jaw because you want me to be able to see the people. You ain't got to see them. When Jacob got old, what happened to Jacob? His eyesight was dim. And stop him on who to bless, though, did it. So guess what I couldn't use? Can't use that situation. Can't use cripple. See, nobody getting by. Everybody trying to find this. I'm guilty. We're all guilty. Because that's a fleshly behavior. If he takes something away from me, it's going to stop me from doing what I need to do for him. Then you look at, is it really for him? Or is it because you worried about how you're going to look to those people? Because I say it's better that I take it from you and you can be saved than you hold on to it and you wind up going to hell. It's better if I leave your blood pressure up or leave you with diabetes or whatever you got. It's better. It's better if I leave you separated from your spouse or your kid gone. It's better than you to have it and you wind up going to hell with it. The mindset we got to have. Everything that's been gone or taken away, it's not to say he might not restore, but our mindset got to be, if I don't get it, if it come back and it'll hinder me and I go to hell, just bless me and be able to stand. Whatever I got, if it don't cause me to go, as painful, as uncomfortable it might be, if it's going to cause me, well, I ain't going to enter in. Lord, just bless me to stand. We don't pray like that. We don't consider that. We so busy, give it back, give it back. And sometimes be the worst thing ever happen. We got to get to a trust point with him to where if he took it, surely he knows. I speak on regard of hurt. I speak on regard of how everybody, people have seen y'all before with your wife. When you first in a situation where you separate, divorce, people look. Oh my goodness, what happened? The biggest part is how people going to look and what people going to say. Was it your fault or their fault? I believe it was your fault. I knew it. If people ever said it wasn't going to work, that will drive us so till we don't consider people going to talk anyway. People going to always talk. Whether you doing something right or wrong, people going to talk. We got to worry about, we got to get, and that's the human part of us. But the word that should come in and yield us life should override or supersede and say, if it's the God glory, I'm going to stand. I don't feel good. It don't mean it don't hurt, but I'm going to stand. Paul told her, having done all therefore, stand, lay down. What does that mean? If I've done everything, man, I done tried to work it out. Still got to stand.
That's right.
First thing I want to know, I just want to know you think I ought to quit. Yes, you should. Yes, you should quit. Yes, you should. You think I ought to stop. Yes, you should. What else can I tell you? Stand. What I'm going to tell you? Because I just want to know from you. You tell me, look at my eye, what you think I ought to just stop right now? Stand, therefore. Don't feel like I make it. What am I going to tell you? What am I going to tell you? Still got to stand. Ain't never time to stop. Amen. You know how many times I want to stop and nourish my wounds? Going through this is just like a battle. A soldier that been in battle, been in combat, no, you something happened, you died, you hurt yourself, something. It ain't even time to even deal with it right now. Somebody would kill beside. Sometimes it just ain't time to deal with that right now. We'll get a time where we'll be able to come back and deal with burying our dead or trying to sit down and try to patch our wound. Right now, I'm just too busy fighting. Sometimes you can't sit around and count up all the casualties right now when you fight. You've been in battle, you sit down, boom, okay, that's one day, boom, hold on, stop. 2 days, boom, okay, three. How long before I wind up being one of them? I'm going to have to deal with the casualty later. Right now, I'm still fighting the warfare. This is what we lack. The way of Yah synagogue. We lack that. You're too busy trying to count up. We can't count it up now. Right now, we're too busy fighting. You ain't even got time to deal with self. You can't be in no battle bullet running over your head, grenade going on, talking about, hello, I'm trying to call, see about a payment before y'all take, boom, yeah, before y'all, yeah, I'm trying to see. I got time to deal with that? But listen, I'm trying to get home right now. If I make it home, I'll deal with that then. This ain't the time. When you guys mess up at, you're too busy entangling too much junk. You can't fight a warfare like that. My soldiers gonna understand, don't you? Some stuff you just, right now, you just can't deal with it. Why call or give you a mess, a letter you read and sudden, I want a divorce, and you got to get ready to go right out here. And they say, we marching out. We got to head out. You got time to deal. You mind if I need to go and I need to call home my wife time. What am I going to do? You got to go. You don't have to deal with that when you get back. Some stuff we can't. This is the mindset. Some of y'all look at, that's unfair. It's not right. What about my feelings? Your feelings, why you a sinner? Your feeling why you ain't saved. You going to trust your feelings? Your feeling why you drift off and why you daydream. You going to keep dealing with your feeling, or you going to deal with, if I keep applying myself, if I get home, he going to make it all right. That's got to be our consolation. What can make a man not worry about what's going on around him? Because it's more important right now that I get home than it is about what I got, trying to fix a relationship with somebody, trying to work. Just let me get home. If I get home, it'll pay for all of this. But I can't fix it here. I'm too worried about trying to get home. You know what you got to do? You got to get a one-track mind now. That's what you guys lack. There are things we can do. There are things that's allowed or allocated to us that we can do that's here. But you just got to know when you got to let that go, and you got to be word-focused. You can't be so deep into so many things that you can't loose yourself from it, that you can't stay. I got to get home at the end of the day. At the end of the day, everything, I got a lot of nice little trinkets. I got not a lot of little gun, a lot of little stuff, little trinket stuff. But guess what? Those things can't rattle me out the way. I got to get home. I don't want nothing. I got to sit here in the time to go, well, hold on, Lord. I put a lot in this. Get that first. Tear it up first. If you would, burn that down first. I don't want none of, because the man I'm naming, I'm praying, I'm calling behind, they staggered not.
Amen.
Should I leave it? I mean, because really I'm in line. My oldest brother died. So if I stay, I can get this. Once I get this, then I can start making everybody him serve the God that I believe. And instead of going way somewhere else, trying to start up something, and already, then I have members right here. I'm going to wait for Isaiah to move, see how the Lord works. That's the problem. We have to believe. And the problem is sometimes I think we take things to a dumbness of level. God created the earth. Genesis 1:1 said, what does it say in the way? God, in the, no, it said what now? God did what? Did heaven and earth. Our Bible is talking about in the day when God created. Nothing comes from nothing. He took something and formed and made it. Then we have to believe the same thing. Because you don't see it, you got to believe he'll make something of it. But you can't make something from nothing. Let's just get out of the super stupid and start the good. Start to value yourself a little better than what other people value, and look at yourself in a better light that you can see yourself being saved. It's not impossible. It's just a matter of choices. You set the day to make a choice. The choice is you've heard the word. The word has told you what's required. Are you willing to do it? You hold that in your hands. He set you with a mind to make decisions. How many of y'all want a cigarette right now? Raise your hand. How many of y'all want a drink? Some of y'all do, you ain't gonna raise your hand. That being honest, because you know you don't look stupid. But those of you that have, how many of you that don't want a cigarette used to smoke? How many of you that don't want a drink used to drink? How many of y'all still drinking? I just want to check. Thank you. I know how bust to her. I was just waiting. I thought you were going to. I had to be asking anyway. Now you made a decision. What drove you to stop? When I stopped smoking cigarettes, it wasn't because of religion. It was because I looked at cancer. I looked at how it darkened up your eyes and brown up your teeth. Start looking at, well, I need to stop. There were reasons that drove me and got me to a point of wanting to stop. There are other things that came in on a religious base that got me from smoking up drugs and got me away from drinking and shacking up into fornication, because I started to feel spiritual. I started to feel the natural death that was going to give first, and then the spiritual death that was going to land me in hell. Something got me to that point to make a decision. He didn't come and make a decision. He didn't come in one morning, I woke up, all my reefer gone. I said, oh, break, he done did it again. Didn't happen. I didn't wake up one morning and all my beer were poured out in the sink and all the cans were mashed up. None of that happened. Choices had to be made. Choices. You got to make a choice. If you set in your mind and heart to make the choice and you start to put application, why wouldn't he receive you? Even Peter looked at with Cornelius, he came, I perceive that God had no risk. At one time, I thought it was just us. But my perception had changed for the fact that he sent men to Joppa for me, who came in to tell you about the same, and you want to keep, you say you here to hear words of me. So I proceeded, God in no respect to prayer, but in every nation, them that feel God and work right is accepted with him. Why wouldn't he do the same thing for you? Now, if he'll do that to a Gentile, they open to them, why would he turn back to his own people? You sit here and you hold a destiny in your own hand to your salvation, and you refuse to even acknowledge it. Your choice. You willingly go to hell, or you willingly be saved. Make no mistake, your mind is made up today to do application, there's going to be opposition. It's going to be a lot of fear, a lot of torment, a lot of things will come at you. But after a while, you condition yourself to suffer against the blow. You look and you wonder how you see people take things, boxer. You condition for it. Medicine ball throw to the air, because you get in there, it's going to be some body blows. Condition yourself how to take punches, how to give punches, how to roll with punches. You wonder, why he do all that getting around? You want, I wish they just stand flat for it. Nigga, is you crazy? Flat-footed, dog, and be knocked out. I got to move. Punch, move, jab, move. I'm fighting. That's the same mindset you had. Don't sit there and let the devil beat you to death. You learn to condition yourself to take certain things. You learn to win us a battle. You got to get out of it. You got to learn when you got the advantage, take advantage of it. That's what we come here to do, to arm ourselves with the same mind. For he that is suffering in the flesh has ceased from sin. That's why you hadn't stopped. Hadn't stopped. Hadn't suffered. Makes a difference. Y'all got to sit here and you got to regulate your mind and make a decision. Honestly, folks, I don't know when myself or you, you're going to leave him. This could be your day. This could be your day of transformation. This could be your day you out of here. This could be the day that God swear against you. Can't wait no longer for you. You heard too much word. You had too much opportunity. Chance. What are you holding on to that you're going to let keep you from being saved? I have two things that I deal with. The joy of seeing his face, and the fear of not doing enough. Not completing what's been laid before me. What's your fear? Even Paul, having revelation, the Lord appearing, the Lord giving him all these things, the signs and wonders. But he told Peter, while we seek to be what, brother? If we ourselves are also found sinners. You're always going to have stuff going to come, no matter how much. But that's a good thing, because it keeps you on a directed path. Sometimes assured that people can be overconfident. You can walk in overconfident. I've seen people blow stuff being too confident. He puts us at a meeting where you always set to be careful with what you do. Even the Bible teacher, be careful for what? Translate. Anxious. You be too quick. Look at those people at Heaven's Gate. Bought a pair of Nike shoes, killed. They said, too quick to go. You got to wait. David said, do what?
What did I say?
And be a what? Man, I'm waiting. I'm waiting. That's all I'm waiting. Wait. You don't want to move too fast. Wait. Hezekiah, when Uzziah, he didn't want to wait on the priest. He ran in on his own, didn't he? What happened to him? Be anxious for nothing. See, after our history, our learning of our law, how it works and how detailed it is and how instructive it is, as Moses was admonished, see that you do all things after the pattern I showed you in the mountain. He was told. Moses got down. Oh, I can see God doing a new thing. No, you don't. Just like I told you in the mountain, do the same thing. Nothing changed. Stop trying to alter it for how you feel and what you think. We got to stay detailed when it comes to the word. Self-obligation, self-ambitions can't override or supersede the word. This is about your soul. You want to create a house? Do it how you want to do it, baby. If you want the kitchen and the bathroom, you ain't committed no sin. I just don't want any eat from now. Because I don't know if you wash your chickens or your wings in the toilet or the sink. But just all of that. No, no. If you want your master bedroom on top of the ceiling or on top of the roof, that's what you want. But when it comes down to your soul, it's already been planned and laid out. The architectural design been set. You can't change that. There are things in life you can alter. You can change. You don't like a certain color, don't use it. Don't paint it. Whatever it is you want to do. You don't like a certain kind of carpet, don't put it in. If you don't like hardwood floor, you want tile, you like magnolia, put it in. But when it comes down to the architecture of your soul, stay with what's already been directed.
Amen.
Can't out that. Got to stay in it. At the end of the day, you got to make choices. You got to look at, are you trying to obtain the spirit? And if you are, what are you willing to do? That's good, brother. Thank the Lord.